Aerial photography has taken me to some interesting places and introduced me to some fantastic people. That's me in the back seat, trying to avoid crashing into a bush. It helps to have some skills to capture these shots, but over the years, I've found it's better to be lucky than good. A Greek philosopher summed it up best when he wrote, "Luck is where the crossroads of opportunity and preparation meet." He must have been an aerial photographer.
Light touch.
G'day, Phil. How you going, mate?
Brett Paull is a lifeguard on Australia's Gold Coast. Brett also shoots video from the air.
The boys are putting together a plan to fly paramotors on the morning glory cloud up in northern Australia. You want to come and film?
What's a morning glory?
No one knows for sure exactly how morning glories are formed. Theories are based on colliding air masses over the Cape York Peninsula. A wave cloud forms, 1,000 kilometers long, traveling at 60 kilometers per hour, producing lift on the front, rotor in the middle, and sinking air on the back. Motor gliders have been riding the lift on the front of these clouds for decades. Hang glider trikes recently. Some hang glider pilots have towed up, but no paragliders have tried it, until now. According to experts in weather and paragliding, flying a paraglider on the glory would be like soaring a ridge in a 60 kilometer per hour wind. It can't be done. Paragliders aren't fast enough. You'll be blown over the back and trashed in the rotor. Glories are not just dangerous, they're far. The only practical access is the remote outback settlement of Burketown. The season for glories is short, from the end of September into October. Glories may only appear once or twice, and some years, they don't show up at all. Motorized aircraft are the most practical way to fly the morning glories for several reasons. When the morning glories arrive late, aircraft will fly 20 kilometers to the coast to meet the clouds. Glories sometimes dissipate after reaching the coast, so some pilots continue on far out over the shark-infested Gulf to reach the cloud earlier for a longer ride. Clouds often come in sets. Like surfing, after the cloud you're soaring dissipates, you can fly over the back and catch the next one. If you do fly over the back of a cloud that hasn't dissipated, you may need a motor to overcome the huge amount of sink on your way to the next cloud. On the bigger clouds, it's possible that the sink on the backside is so strong that even with a motor, you can't stay in the air. Well, maybe in a fighter jet. The motor is also the best option for getting back to Burketown. Gliders have ridden glories for 500 kilometers over areas with no road access and limited landing options. Without a motor, these distance flights would not be practical.
So how about it, Phil?
Brett, you guys are crazy.
So we'll see you in September then.
Have I mentioned that I'm not a morning person?
I love chasing records, and I like chasing it for the personal achievement, for pushing my boundaries, for doing the research and achieving something that hasn't been done before. The morning glory was very much like this.
Chris Atkinson told me, rang me up and said, "I've got a project I want you to be part of." And as soon as he went through the details, it didn't take me long and I was in, because it sounded incredibly exciting.
The boys have all launched in their paramotors, so we're going to go buzz them and see if we can get some great shots.
Chris was talking about 3 years ago, okay, of going up to the morning glory. At first, I didn't even know what the morning glory is, okay. Even though I play only a very small part of it, I was very happy to go up there. It was the first time I was ever in the outback, that far in the outback.
I thought this will be interesting because I've read a bit about the morning glory, and I thought these guys are doing something that's really out there, in that gliders fly it and the wind's 80, 90 k's and paragliders can't handle that sort of stuff. So I thought, if they can do this, it's going to be excellent.
I thought he was crazy, actually. I didn't know a lot about the morning glory, but went away, did some reading, watched the videos, looked at YouTube, and the more I watched, the more I thought he was crazy.
Yeah, Ben, we've got enough light to see over the back. Yeah, absolutely awesome. There's many more coming.
Chris and I had sort of helped each other with the world records that we'd done individually, and I really look forward to it because it was something that we could do together.
One of the biggest dangers with doing the morning glory for paraglider is it hasn't been done before, so you don't know what to expect. The other aircraft don't fold up and disappear above your head. Other planes that have done this before are all rigid wing. Paragliders are a completely different animal. Our biggest fear going up into this was going through the back of a cloud. It's incredibly dangerous to sink on the backside. No one wants to get hurt. No one wants to see anyone else get hurt. So you cover all the bases, but there's still the unknown you're going into.
This is meteorologist Tom Kiefer. I asked Tom to share his thoughts about paragliding on the Morning Glory the night before I left for Australia.
So Phil, I don't know if you want to do this or not. I looked at a lot of the data, and the air in front of the Morning Glory cloud is moving extremely fast, possibly faster than the glider can fly. So if you do try to fly it, it's possible that there is a sweet spot in the front where you could soar the lift band. But if you get behind it, it's going to go bad. There's extreme turbulence with downdrafts that go all the way to the ground. If you do lose your glider, it's unlikely that your reserve parachute's going to work. This is why it's never been flown before. If you get sucked over the back of that cloud, it's likely the last thing you'll ever do.
Ready to go. See you, dog. Look after mummy, okay? Look after the house. Right. Time to hit the road.
Well-deserved beer after what have we done? 16 hours? 17-hour drive? So, another 8 to go.
Cheers, Big Bill.
Banjo Patterson wrote Waltzing Matilda, which is our unofficial anthem. Have you heard the song?
I have.
Yeah. Well, he wrote that at Combo Waterhole, which is only about 12, 15 kilometres out of here.
Michael J. Crocodile Dundee.
Never, never, safaris.
Yeah.
Part of 25 hours on the road, 2,200 kilometres, give or take. It's now 9 o'clock and we're just arriving in Burketown, so it's been a long, long, long journey for sure.
Tiring.
We're all knackered, nothing a beer and a
rest after the long trip won't fix, and
we'll be ready to go tomorrow, so bring it on.
After pulling into the Burketown Caravan Park, we are informed that there will probably be a cloud in the morning.
The next thing, there were bits and pieces of motors everywhere, and then I think even at 11:30 at night, I heard a motor start up momentarily.
We should hook up the bridle, because it's not going to do much good unless we do that.
Yeah.
We are dog-tired from the drive, and with half a world of jet lag, I'm double-tired.
That'll help.
The problem is if you adjust it too much, it'll roll up on you.
Yeah.
As a result of last-minute equipment choices and logistics, I would be attempting to fly and film on the cloud using a paramotor and wing I'd never flown.
They say you're not supposed to do more than one new thing at a time.
Yeah, well, if you're in Australia, there's
one bedroom, isn't it?
Right.
Bedroom sounds pretty good right now. What time is it anyway?
After 3 hours of sleep, Burketown Airport is like one of those weird dreams where you can't tell whether you're awake or still dreaming. Matt warms up his motor and double-checks his reserve. Chris gets his motor running after some difficulty. My motor is a different story.
Can you help
help you up. If it falls down, don't worry, I'll lay it out, okay?
Okay.
So don't unclip, okay? I'll help you there and
perfect.
Make sure you
come. Well, the stars are starting to drift away and the sun's not far from coming up. It's been a long road getting here. But it looks like we're finally gonna get in the air. Looks like a cloud's on the way. We don't know whether this one's gonna be a good one or a bad one, but we're gonna for sure get in the air and start moving towards it and see what happens.
I'm not sure, mate. It's so disorientated, isn't it?
So, Chris was working on it. I don't know what's going on.
Watch out for, right? They're long and flat, they'll be fast and have not much lift. Alright, so it's easy to go through the back. He said they go through the back of the sailplane. Alright, so
stay
aware.
Away from the long flat
just
ones.
Be careful of really long flat ones going over the back.
They all look long and flat to me.
The vertical ones have got a heap of vertical lift on them.
Alright.
You got no problems with lift. The long flat ones you'll go over the back if you're not watching what you're doing.
Starting to blow already. At least that'll make the launch easy, but it's a little uneasy launching into an early morning breeze like this, knowing what's coming.
This looks like the beginning of it. They always say you get a strong wind front come through. It's a little bit eerie, really. It's the fog settling through, the wind picking up like this. Went from being very still, very calm to this within about a minute. So it's
hang on, wait. Hold on that tip. Thank you.
That was a morning glory. 2 minutes later, it's calm.
So was that actually
that was a morning glory
going over, wasn't it?
Another is approaching and will arrive in a few minutes.
Yeah, where do we go from here?
What's that?
We planned to be in the air when they come and hit, but now, yeah, what do we do?
What do you reckon, Chris?
I'll lay my wing out. I'll go and give it a try. I'm going to have a look what you think it's like.
When we realised it's all going to be go, I was scared. I was frightened. You know, I was thinking, boy, I don't know what we've got ourselves into. Oh, I've got to be crazy. I've got to be mad.
I'll lay my wing out, Herbert.
That was a morning glory, yeah?
Yeah.
How about that, huh?
Yeah.
Interesting experience, huh?
Yeah, it is. Another one coming. You can see the line in the cloud?
Right.
Second one coming.
Fantastic. Well, that's our first one. A little warm-up, huh?
A little warm-up, yeah.
Okay. Get ready now. As soon as this one's gone, launch.
Be careful.
Always.
Can't see, are you on top of the cloud?
Yeah, right on the end of it, eh? Middle of the bum,
kilometres. I know you guys are probably concentrating, but what's it like? Is it smooth? Lots of lift?
Yeah, dead smooth. Lift, nah, not much.
You can see another one on the horizon coming through, can you?
Yeah, three. Hey, Matt, I can see you. Turn to your right, come back towards us.
Guys, we've already got fantastic footage. I just want to let you know.
Good work, but look what's coming.
As the glory weakens, we decide to risk sink and rotor and fly over the back towards the next glory. The sink and rotor are practically non-existent, probably because the glory had dissipated.
All right, feedback from the sailplane pilots. They're sitting at 2,200 feet. The cloud is traveling through at roughly 60k an hour and they're reporting 5 meter a second lift. So you want to make sure you guys stay well in front of it. Also, guys, just be aware that it looks like there's about 6 morning glories coming through.
Hey, guys, it's Ben. I know you're having a bit of fun up there, but do you want one of us to start heading down the highway and start following you so you might have some landing options?
We don't know where we're going to go.
That's all right, mate. Nothing to commit, obviously. Enjoy first, but just wondering whether you want me to head down that way.
Yeah, I don't really know, mate. This is fucking awesome.
Yeah, I'll tell you what, mate, it's got me tempted, you lucky bastard.
It's smooth as a baby's bottom.
Hey, you're going to want to think about getting a little bit lower than that, Matt.
Yeah, Matt's still really high. He needs to come down.
Okay, so we're all chasing each other higher, but we need to get lower.
I'm going down a bit.
We are not only too high, we are too far back.
That's a light spiral, still not losing height.
These glories are not the iconic roll clouds. Their scattered shapes make it difficult to find the front edge, and without realizing it, we were almost over the back with the cloud forming out in front of us. You can see that here as we move out in front of the cloud.
Unbelievable. Unbelievable.
Well done, Phil. Well
done. Good job. Good job. Good job.
Good job.
Yeah, we got some fun video.
Yeah.
Unbelievable. Brought tears to my eyes up there. Incredible. Unbelievable. Well done, Phil.
Thank you.
I'm not allowed to talk to the camera, but great effort.
Thank you.
Geez, you covered some ground.
We nearly had to let you walk.
Well done,
buddy.
Thanks, mate. What a fucking job. I'm going to see you.
Thank you.
So, even though I didn't do the cloud that you just got on my thumb, I think I'm still the best pilot here. I'll just get out of their way, otherwise they'll moan.
Clear prop.
It's 4:30 and sailplane pilots are already pre-flighting their aircraft. Though there's nothing visible on the horizon, conditions again favor morning glories. If the glories are coming, they are still far out over the Gulf of Carpentaria.
So, doesn't it make sense to try and take off early and fly towards it and ride it back this way?
No, I'm gonna fly.
Maybe we should get going.
Yesterday, when we headed off towards the glories, I had met Chris and Matt 35 hours prior. Today, once again, We are relying on each other and the ground crew as we approach the unknown.
Yeah, guys, we've had confirmation from one of the pilots that there is a Morning Glory coming through.
In the days ahead, the team would come to realize that filming the Morning Glory from the air was like trying to film a wild animal in its native habitat. You don't know whether you'll find one, and if you do find one, you don't know whether it will be friendly or bite.
That looks like it's a problem with the secondary there, Matt. That secondary looks a fair bit bigger.
It looks fucking huge.
I think we need to still keep climbing, eh?
Yeah, I think so. I'd love a drink of water right now.
Well, which side of this river should we be on?
The left-hand side, mate. As we're flying forward, the left-hand side. No one will land anywhere up in here, mate, I'll tell you.
Hey, fellas, I'm not paying much attention. I've got a broken speed bar.
That's okay. I'm watching you and getting some great video.
Yeah, that's no good. You can't do it, Chris. No bar. We turn it back.
All right, I'm back. Phil, I think we need to be climbing hard.
We'll hop onto the first one and ride it a bit, and then we'll see and check out the second one, eh?
Be careful with the first one. It looks like one of them low flat ones they warned us about.
81 kilometres an hour.
So you got your heart rate going a little bit?
Just watch it. Everybody watch their ground speed, eh? Everybody watch their ground speed. Just jump this one.
How much left of us?
By the time we reach the second cloud, the first cloud is gone, but lift on this one is strong.
I don't like a drink of water at the moment.
Can you pass me one too, please?
So which is worse, being thirsty or having to pee?
That's riveting audio for the DVD, guys.
There's a star plane coming up on your film.
I have him in sight. We're crossing the river, don't forget, and there's a tailwind. We're crossing it with a tailwind.
Can I look for some crocs on the way back?
Copy, Ben.
Yes, Matt, how are you guys going?
Just, fly the Morning Glory, Ben.
Oh, yeah, nice to hear. So you just pop on over, would you?
Have you seen any crocs down there?
Not yet, but they're down there. They love eating Americans.
I'm going to change my nationality.
I think there was a lot of a buzz and a lot of excitement around Burketown for what we were doing. I think in any sport there's always the different opinions and, you know, different generations, but I think a lot of the pilots there knew that no one had ever done this before.
I think we were accepted extremely well by most of the sailplane pilots there. There were a few that had concerns about us being on the cloud with them. But I think once they saw us up there, they knew that we had the skills and we were able to get ahead of the cloud if we needed to.
I think everyone there knew what the Bound for Glory team was and what we were trying to achieve. So as soon as we sort of announced on VHF that, you know, with the ground crew, you know, gave us very precise information that I actually think probably made it possible the first time to fly the cloud.
I'm climbing steadily, mate. I'm going through 4,000 feet and there is four or five glories, one behind the other.
Flying the Morning Glory since 95 every year. When I first came out, I was in a little home built. It's pretty daunting, in a little 11-metre monorail. Yeah, it just keep coming back.
It was just absolutely incredible that they took the time out to help us and relayed all the information back to us to make our experience much safer.
Loosen it enough so we can twist it around.
Can you hear me, Kevin? I can't hear you. Can you hear me now?
The team is encouraged by our success, but also a bit disappointed.
Looks like good stuff.
Great stuff.
Want to snow it?
The clouds, they weren't the classic iconic roll clouds that we'd seen in pictures and in movies. So we were really, really hoping to get onto one of those big round roll clouds that we've seen in the pictures.
as sailplane pilot John Spilsbury shares some of his scarier morning glory experiences, Matt starts thinking twice about wishing for one of those big roll clouds. John senses our concerns and gives us his version of Morning Glory 101.
So if you want to get higher, you've got to move further away from the cloud. It's not up here, because it's starting to go back. You get caught in this, can't get back.
Right.
So you've got to stay in the front third of the cloud, but the maximum height is 45 degrees from the crest out. Not much to it.
And then sailplane pilot Jeff Pratt gives us a dose of reality that brings our previous 2 days into perspective.
The clouds that we've had the last couple of days have been like, that's the minimum.
After explaining that we'd been flying the small clouds, he then tells us that on our first day, a motor glider flew over the back and encountered so much sink that it was forced all the way down onto the ground, landing in a pasture nearly missing some cows.
What do you think of this? You think we're nuts?
No, I don't think you're nuts. Good on you. No, go for it.
Good morning, Brett.
G'day, mate. How you going?
Good. What we got?
We've got Groundhog Day is what we've got.
Offshore winds are the first sign that there'll be no glories today. The team gets some airtime and a little mustering. Then back to catch up on some chores. Herbert, who we've now nicknamed Herman, takes us on a tour of the only store in Burketown.
Chocolates, sweets. But where it gets really interesting is when you have to look at the price of onions. $8.40. You get a head of lettuce in Brisbane for about $1.50. Okay. Here it's $5.52 per. You can't get any fresh bread. Bread comes frozen. The choice of clothes in Burketown, you can't. I don't know, if you need pants, I think you have to go to next town. That's the movie rental. Okay. And of course, post office and convenience shop all in one.
And you. $4.25, thank you.
Well, that was it, huh?
Phil, here's your plate.
Thank you.
Have dinner.
How is it?
Fantastic. Herman is the best cook in the BFG team. In fact, he's the only cook.
What he can do with 2 minute noodles, no one else can ever do it.
What do you got going there?
Vegetarian food.
As evening approached, we did what most paramotor pilots do, look for a place to fly. Burketown is on the edge of huge mudflats. Chris and Matt and I had flown across them this morning on the way to meet the glories at the coast. On the way, Scott Milne showed up. Back home, Scott herds cattle with this gyro. They call it mustering in Australia. Scott was looking forward to flying the glories with us and was anxious to hear about our flights. The sailplane pilots came along. They wanted to get a closer look at our contraptions in action. Everyone was standing around, and when I asked what they were waiting for, they said it was too windy. I showed them a Cobra launch. They'd never seen one before. Here's Chris trying his first Cobra. No one likes the camera in these situations, but Chris, as always, is a good sport about it. Herman kept calling it a snake launch instead of a Cobra launch, so we felt okay calling him Herman instead of Herbert. Matt does a perfect snake launch on his first try. Come to think of it, I don't think I ever saw Matt blow a launch. Brett starts out okay, but he's not willing to commit to pulling that left brake. Here's an amazing first try by a paramotor pilot who came all the way up to Burketown just to watch us fly the morning glories. Now Brett's pulling the A risers too hard. Here he finally eases up. After experiencing the incredible hospitality of my Australian hosts, it was an honor to have the opportunity to give a little something back. Here's Chris doing a perfect high wind inflation. Herman knocked out an excellent snake launch. His determination during this launch earned him the new title, Herman the Herminator. This limitless playground with glassy smooth air was a welcome reward for the entire team. You could do a foot drag literally for hours with hardly a turn. The team tried formation flying for the first time. After a bit, they got the hang of it. We also tried formation flying at other locations on the way home from Burketown. The team hoped these shots would show their appreciation to the glider manufacturer for helping to sponsor this trip.
It's just gone 4 o'clock in the morning. We're just using the car window here as a sign for condensation. So what that's telling us is that the chances of glory is very high.
We decided to launch from the mudflats, in part due to concerns expressed by a couple of sailplane pilots about us launching at the airport.
I think our practices and procedures were first class. I did like launching from the airport, but when we got out to the salt flats, it was much more relaxed.
Once again, there would be no glories, only a glorious Australian sunrise. So the ground crew followed us into the air. Following in a hang glider trike, Bill Olive and Brett capture a different angle. Today, we decide to expand our boundaries beyond the barren mudflats to the mangroves. Here's a wild boar. Wallabies like this one are most active at dawn and dusk. Watch how fast they change direction. The river is beautiful and teeming with crocodiles. This is typically all you see, unless you land in the river. Light aircraft like Scott's gyrocopter are a way of life in the Australian outback. Distances are far and roads are scarce. Flying is often the only practical way to travel. Flying the outback in a paramotor was magical.
That is ugly, look at it. Hang on, I'll just improve the image, Phil. About an hour ago, about 3:30, a blue cloud comes through, huh?
Big one.
Yeah. So that was the campsite here, I was still, and all of a sudden a bit of wind ripped through here, and but now it's gone back still again.
Whew. What's going on?
Well, just a normal, usual morning chaos. Making coffee. Second. I don't know what the chances are this morning of a morning glory, but either way, you always start the day with a good coffee. Plus, I know our cameraman doesn't operate too well without it.
What's going on, Herman?
I'm ready for the next adventure. Whether it's wildlife or another glory, and maybe decide to go up finally, if I don't get too scared.
Every morning, Matt and Chris pretend to mix my fuel incorrectly.
We're putting oil in it too, eh?
Oil?
Oil. You don't want oil in it?
No.
Okay.
What do we got this morning?
Oh, I think it'll be a beautiful day. I don't think you'll get a morning glory. But you never know. You got to be there, don't you?
No glories again. Bob Bauer drove 1,500 kilometers to support the team as designated paramotor mechanic. Bob's help would turn out to be crucial in the days ahead. Bob's friend Dave tagged along to test his courage on the glory. Burketown was starting to look like an ultralight convention. Here's Brett trolling for what the Aussies call handbags with teeth. This is the third day with no glories. There is a growing concern that we may not get another. Pilots can wait in Burketown for a month and never get a cloud. Ben and Brett have decided they will fly on the next glory. Their fear of the cloud is fading, and they are more afraid that they may not get another chance. We know the engine can quit at any time, but when it actually happens, it's a wake-up call.
What is that?
Yeah, it's a throttle cable. Snap while I was chasing some pig.
While flying on a morning glory, if you have an engine out with a paramotor, you can soar the cloud until it dissipates and land safely. But if you drift too far back, without the engine, you will probably toss your reserve while falling through the cloud.
How's it going today, mate?
Beat, tired.
Yeah, it's been a big few days, hasn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah. So they're predicting a bigger cloud today. And we're going to take a few of the pilots that haven't been onto the cloud before, so we're going to have to be a little apprehensive and a little careful about how we go about things today, I think.
Trying to get the right frame of mind. A little bit apprehensive and nervous this morning. But I suppose it's a good thing to be apprehensive and take it carefully.
I mean, you can call it scared, you can call it apprehensive, you can call it worried, you can call it excited. There's a whole range of emotions going through.
Take it one step at a time. That's all I can say.
Well, you can never do in life, huh?
Yeah, yeah.
It's all looking promising, according to reports. You never know until you get in the air, do you?
As we crossed the mud flats again towards the coast, we received a report that several smaller glories had been spotted over the Gulf. The plan was that the less experienced pilots would hang back until Chris and Matt and I reached the coast and assessed the situation.
We really wanted them to fly the clouds, but we did have concerns. That's why we positioned them a long way back with altitude, so to make sure they were safe.
Meanwhile, in a motor glider, Mark and John were already over the Gulf connecting with the first cloud.
And we actually did cloud surfing where we actually flew from one to the other and went out about six layers of clouds. And that was amazing because you were soaring along a cloud bank, get to the end of the wave, so to speak, where it broke up, and then jump over to the next wave and then go back along that one. It's like when you're surfing, you're going out to the next break. And we were getting about 800 feet a minute sync between waves. But once we got to within 100 metres of the cloud, we were getting into positive lift at 400 feet a minute. So if you know the spacing, it's just being able to keep your power up and to the next wave. It's the same as paddling over the back to get the next set.
To get an idea of how much lift even these smaller glories produce, watch how Mark and John get higher and higher. And they're in a motor glider carrying two people, engine off. At the coast, it was just Chris and me. Matt had turned back because his motor was not developing sufficient power. Chris decided conditions were safe, so Ben and Brett headed towards us.
Like probably most paramotor pilots, I like to skim along the ground and low. So my ceiling, I think the highest I'd been up till this trip was around 2,000 feet. So just the nerves start to get me past 1,000 feet. But with the cloud coming, I knew that we had to go up. So I was watching the altimeter and it went from 1,000, 2,000, 3,000. I think personally, once I got past about 3,000 feet, the nerves had settled. The air was really smooth. We eventually got to just over 6,000 feet and magnificent. I mean, I need to get to that altitude more because it's a different world up there. And luckily Phil got some of that on video, and it's going to be incredible over the coming years to watch that vision, and it'll take me back to that time when I was really, really, really happy and excited at the same time. Scared, all the feelings, so what a flight.
The four of us waited at the coast for the glories. None of us was willing to risk an engine out over water. The haze in the air is actually smoke from a fire, which enabled us to see blue glories that are otherwise invisible. Blue glories have lifting and sinking air like visible glories, which makes them potentially dangerous. You may not realize you're on the backside of a strong blue glory until it's too late. Today, all the glories, blue or white, had good lift and manageable sink.
Yeah, well done, Brennan Brett. It's a pretty special thing to get on these clouds.
We got the fly-through glories. Okay, they weren't the big white fluffy ones, but what a feeling.
How's it going this morning, Phil?
It's kind of old hat now, isn't it?
Ah, yeah.
Yeah, it's flown one glory, flown them all.
That's right.
Yeah, I wish it was the case.
Tell us a story. Well, what we got is the mother of all morning glories coming through right now. And we're going to let this one go. And hopefully there'll be one behind it. And we will hopefully be in the air before that one comes through.
That is a monster. Look at the size of it. It's a little bit eerie in the dark.
What's that?
Three in 10 minutes we've had.
Yeah.
That's the third one now.
Yeah.
All we need is some light.
Oh, it's mine.
What are you thinking, Matty?
Oh, I don't know, mate. I just think they're a bit close together today.
Such a shame the sun's not up. It's, to see this in daylight would just be breathtaking. We've had a few come through, but to see, what, three back-to-back almost to the point where they're joined together to make one almighty massive cloud is just incredible.
Yeah. See the bottom. That's what I can see before, the bottom of it.
Yeah.
This is the one I want to be on.
What do you think? Yeah. Want to let this little one go and get up to where that big one?
We decided to let the little one go and this great big one go past. We just weren't ready. This 1 minute time lapse compresses 40 minutes as we prepare to launch. The glories are close together, forming and growing as they pass overhead. A gap opens up, and in the distance, we can see a glory that looks like a good one. Well-formed, nothing in front of it. Chris launches. Then me. Matt is only a few minutes behind, but those few minutes would turn out to make all the difference that day. In a few more minutes, the glory that we're chasing passed, and suddenly the skies cleared into a sunny spring morning. But we were already far downwind, and our view was a bit different. Chris and I are climbing up between the glories. Matt is in heavy sync below.
Yeah, Phil, they're pretty close together. I'm in the sync of this one here. I'm going to have to turn back to the one behind. Actually, I've got a fairly good lift right now, right here. All right, I'm coming back to you. Matt, copy, Chris. Where are you and what are you up to? I'm underneath that cloud and I'm getting 6 meters per second down. 6 meters per second sync. Yeah, that's amazing because I'm not that far from you and I'm going up.
Unable to overcome the sink, Matt returns to base camp.
What happened?
Yeah, mate, just they wired it out and just couldn't climb up. And then I got a bit of a climb and then 6 meters per second down. And then, ended up only being a few meters off the ground before I sort of could level out. And then they were wired out, couldn't see them.
It's just saying, buddy.
Yeah. So it just goes to show how 2 or 3 minutes can make all the difference, eh?
That's all it took, wasn't it?
Yeah.
How you feeling though? Disappointed?
Oh yeah, a bit disappointed, yeah.
Yeah.
At 5,000 feet, we were riding the wave, racing downwind faster than we'd ever flown before. We made it up. But now the concern was getting down. The gaps between the glories were narrow and threatening to close in completely, which would be a very bad situation. I suggested to Chris that we stay on the glories for a while and hope they open up.
Yeah, Phil, I think you're right. Ben, copy, Chris.
Yeah, Chris, copy. Go ahead.
We're on the radar gauge at Gregory Downs. These things are massive. It's a little bit dangerous to come down at the moment. We might just follow these out for a while, see how it goes.
Yeah, mate, we're in the car making chase. Sitting behind this thing, that cloud is huge. It is a big one. I'm actually doing 80K down the road and it's getting away from me.
Following the road to Gregory Downs was our only chance for retrieval. Otherwise, landing deep in the outback could mean hours or even days of walking. To head towards Gregory Downs, we can't stay on one glory and ride it in a straight line. The clouds are pushing us too far to the west. Instead of flying straight, we must jump back from wave to wave to compensate for the westerly push. But today, going over the back is far more dangerous. The Glory is surrounded by a parcel of air that moves with it, pushing the static air up and out of its way. When we go over the back, we exit the air moving with the Glory and enter the static air, and the Glory quickly pulls away. We need to be high enough to avoid the sink pulling us into the cloud, but today, the Glories are close together and tall, so if we go too high, we can't descend quickly enough to get onto the front of the next cloud. If we overshoot, we could get sucked into the back of that cloud or find ourselves on the next Glory. Skipping a Glory might not sound dangerous, but today, sections of the Glories are embedded in other clouds, like these shots taken from John's sailplane. In this situation, it's extremely difficult to tell where the Glory is. We could fly over the back of a huge Glory and not realize it until it's too late. We also don't want to be on a Glory that's closed in, with no gap between the clouds, because an engine failure would result in a descent through clouds. But trying to get a look at the next cloud to see if it's safe is almost impossible, because as we climb up to see over the back, we enter the static air, which starts to drag us over the back.
Hey Phil, copy Chris.
Chris, go ahead.
Yeah, I'm at 5,000. Just watch that cloud on my left there. Just watch the fog come up off it and how it's rolling towards the top and still growing.
Maybe we should go a little bit higher.
Yeah, we'll keep climbing. Just be careful we don't get sucked into this.
You know, I think we're starting to drift over the back here. Let's punch out.
Hey, copy. Going to full bar.
Chris, copy Ben.
Yeah, copy.
Mate, I'm really struggling to keep up with this cloud in the car. What sort of speed are you guys doing there?
Just clocking up 103, 106 kilometres an hour.
Yeah, this is Phil. I'm showing about 104, 105. Holy crap, guys, you're moving quick. Look, you're going to sort of outrun me. There's no way I can do those sort of speeds on these roads.
So Chris and I were on our own, in the middle of nowhere. Just the two of us. Not a care in the world.
I'm having a heck of a time seeing the ground here, Chris. There's not a lot of ground to be seen. So, do you know where we're going here?
Yeah, Phil, got a GPS here, just trust me. I think we need to climb, cross over this Glory into the next valley. The next valley looks a bit more open.
I'm right behind you.
We're showing about 45Ks from Gregory Downs.
You think the pub will be open?
Bloody hope so.
Hey guys, you've probably covered by now about 120 kilometres. How's your fuel situation?
Yeah, I can see fuel tanks. He's got plenty, so I'll have heaps.
Yeah, we're really not using that much fuel, except for these climbs when we're going over the back of one Glory onto another.
10 kilometres from Gregory Downs, the Glories were open enough for us to safely spiral down between them.
Yeah, the wind's pretty strong down here, guys. Pretty gusty. It has been picking up as the day goes on. So just be careful if you're coming in.
These Glories weren't the iconic roll clouds we were hoping for, but we had accomplished something far more important. We covered over 100 kilometers in a little more than an hour, using hardly any fuel, proving the concept that paragliders can successfully fly cross-country by riding the Glories.
So what's happening?
Just filling up your motor. You have enough fuel and don't have an outlanding.
So what do you think of the chances of the Glory this morning?
Oh, probably 20%, but you've got to be up just to make sure, don't you?
That's right.
20% more than staying in bed.
That's right.
Well, just in case, on the off chance the morning Glory does come through, you've got to make sure we've got all the cameras hooked up and ready to go.
I would say, I agree with Chris, probably 25 to 50%, because looking at the weather charts, the air flows the wrong way, so I think there will be a Glory, but it'll be out to sea and it'll probably get burned off. It might even be 75 k's off the coast.
So what do you think? You're going to go up in this?
No, I'll just be ground crew.
Right.
And support the guys.
So what's your take, Herbert?
For me? Yeah, I'm ready to rock and roll and hopefully we get a flight in. Maybe I can chase some bigs too for a change.
With little chance of a Glory, the plan is to go back to the mangroves, but But after launching, we spot some interesting ground fog out over the mudflats and decide to explore that instead. Meanwhile, the ground crew reports that they are not able to reach any sailplane pilots, which seems to confirm our assessment that there will be no glories today. After capturing some low-level shots, Matt and I climb up to get a different angle. Far off in the distance, over the gulf, I see something that looks like a thin white line.
Guys, I think I see a glory.
Climbing high towards the coast, our eyes are glued to the hazy horizon, trying to sort out the size and shape of the only cloud in the sky.
Hey Ben, copy Ben.
Yeah, Matt, go ahead.
Can you get some info from John or Jeff regarding the clouds? How high they are, how many of them there is?
Yeah, mate, been trying to reach them for a while now. I actually think they're a long way out, but we'll keep trying. As soon as I get an update, I'll let you know.
As we wait for reports, the glory grows bigger in the window. It's difficult to get used to flying towards bad weather. Matt takes a sip of water and offers some to Chris. Several kilometers ahead in a hang glider trike, Brett and Bill Olive are approaching the glory at twice the speed of a paramotor.
Bill is a hang glider trike pilot that's done the cloud many, many times. So a vast amount of experience. And the plan was to actually go up with Billo, well, this is what I thought at the time, to film some of the paragliders. And the actual cloud we got to that morning was, look, it's a life experience. I'll never ever forget it.
This is the cloud we've been waiting for. Reports are favorable. We are in a perfect position to approach. Suddenly, Chris drops back out of view.
I've got a bloody problem here. Engine's killed, died. I've got to turn back. I'm going to try to make it back across the river.
I always thought that the assessment of the cloud should be a three-way decision. So if Chris had concerns about the cloud, we would turn back. If Phil had concerns about the cloud, we would turn back. If I had concerns about the cloud, we would turn back. Chris had been so much of a part of the team, and when he wasn't there, it was a bit scary not to have him there for his assessment and skills at looking at the cloud as well.
Matt turns back to follow Chris towards the river. When Brett first called me, I thought paragliding the Morning Glory was crazy. How could we have the skills and knowledge to pull this off when everyone else said it couldn't be done? The answer was Chris. His positive can-do attitude, willingness to learn, and unwavering friendship had infected us all.
All right, Matt, looks like it's just you and me.
When Chris had to turn back with engine troubles, I really thought, yeah, maybe we should, you know, turn back ourselves. But when Phil said it to me, it's you and me, Matt, that instantaneously made me turn back towards the cloud.
I'm heading back towards the cloud. Where are you?
I'm right with you.
When we got to the cloud, I wasn't aware, but Billo turned the motor off. And it so turned out that Billo was going for a world record in a two-seat trike with engine off. And the current record was around 48 kilometres or something like that. So for the next hour and a bit, we soared back and forth on the cloud, and we covered just on 50 kilometres by the end, setting a provisional world record. So I didn't do a lot in the back seat there, but I'll take it.
Until now, we had only seen the iconic Morning Glory in photos and videos. As we approach this cloud, we come to the realization that they are a lot bigger in real life. and this is a medium-sized cloud. These shots of other aircraft taken by Brett from the hang glider trike help to provide a sense of scale. That's Scott Milne and his wife, engine idling, riding the Glory in a fully loaded two-place gyrocopter. Matt and I slow our closure rate by doing S-turns and setting up our approach at an angle to the cloud. We are already encountering lift far from the cloud, and that's a concern. If we misjudge and climb into the static air above the Glory, and the lift is strong, we won't be able to descend quickly enough to get back into the parcel of air moving with the Glory before we are swept over the back. If we approach lower and we can't keep up with the cloud, like all the experts say we can't, then we might not be high enough to go over the back without getting sucked through the cloud. That's the crux of it all. Fly 1,000 meters above the Glory, and you can sip champagne while you take in the view. But you can't ride the Glory unless you are willing to go low, where in 5 seconds, you can go from being safely on the Glory to on your way over the back and through the cloud, no matter what you do. Closer now, we fly parallel to the Glory. As far as we can tell, we are still in the static air, not yet moving with the Glory. From here, we can either go lower and move closer, or stay high and move closer. We choose to stay high. Directly over the leading edge of the cloud, it only takes a few seconds to realize we guessed wrong. We are too high, in the static air, and drifting over the back. We have only a few seconds to react. We immediately try to push out in front of the cloud and descend. Trimmers out, full speed bar, engine idling. With some maneuvering room between us and the cloud, some turns help us lose more altitude. After several minutes, we are low and far enough out in front to relax and collect our thoughts. We had just run away from the best Glory we'd seen. Not willing to give up, we turn back towards the cloud. This time, we're going to stay low and meet the cloud head on. We will either get onto the Glory or go through it. Like stepping through a magic doorway, we were on the Glory.
How about that, Matt?
Hey, fucking hell.
Good job.
Awesome, mate.
That was awesome.
That was incredible.
When Chris got out of the retrieve vehicle, The first thing he did was congratulate Matt and myself.
Well done.
Thank you.
Well done.
Chris had missed out on the best cloud, but he never complained, not once. His priority was not his own accomplishment, but rather what we accomplished as a team.
These trips don't happen without a team. And one of the most important things is planning the right team. We have a wide experience base and the right people for the right jobs. Like Herbert, he's very underspoken, but without people like Herbert, these sort of events don't happen. He states that they're not a big part of the team. They really are. They're just as big a part as the pilots or the camera crew or anyone else. Without them, it doesn't happen. And so thank you very much to everyone who was involved. And congratulations to Matt and Phil that did a spectacular job and flew some awesome clouds and made the trip worthwhile. You know, it's about sharing experience with other people, and it was a great experience. Very well done.
We're part of the Paull for Glory crew.
BFG pilots, copy Ben.
Yeah, go ahead Ben.
Can you guys give us an update of your position, roughly where you are?
We're out here somewhere.
Yeah, thanks for that. I'll start looking somewhere.
Chris has been talking about it for a while, and when I saw hang gliders fly it back in the 1995s, I always thought how good it would be to fly it on a hang glider. And then it just progressed as my paragliding experience increased. So we started to look at it for paragliding and paramotoring.
Why not? It's so spectacular. Big wave surfers, on a 50-foot wave. Flying, this wave can be 10,000 foot high. You know, that's just absolutely awesome. The power and the size and just the sheer beauty.
A lot of pilots have gone up over the years, some of them have spent 2 months there and not seen a cloud. So we were extremely lucky to go up, what do we have, 3 hours sleep, wake up in the morning and get a cloud the first day in the first couple of hours is unheard of. We were lucky, really lucky.
Very, very lucky. I mean, to drive 27 hours, set up paramotors to 1 o'clock in the morning and then roll up at an airport at 5 o'clock in the morning and take off and fly into it was supreme luck, but the rest of the days was a little bit more than luck.
Mark, do you want to get his wing ready for him? Are you ready?
Well, I don't know if I should launch yet, but...
Which wing is it?
I don't know which wing it is.
Let me just put my first morning in perspective. 24 hours of travel to get from San Diego to Brisbane, and then about 20 to 27 hours driving across Queensland, going to bed at 1 o'clock after trying to set up my little tent, getting up at about 4 in the morning, and people saying, there's a glory coming. I'm like, oh my God, am I ready? So you get to the airport and you got your headlamp on because you can't see, and there's an amazing amount of fog and everything is damp, and you're trying to get the camera gear ready, and you're trying to get into a paramotor that you've never flown and make sure that the reserve and the speed bar are hooked up correctly because you might need both of those.
Yeah, look at this.
We're on the launch pad there at the airport, and at the same time there's glider pilots, there's hang glider pilots, gyro pilots, they're all getting ready to do their stuff, and we're in the infield with our little craft, obviously the smallest they'd ever seen up there to tackle a cloud. And all of a sudden, the wind just picked up suddenly and came through really strongly. And a few comments were, geez, look at that wind gust. Look at that. Geez, that's strong. And one of the experienced pilots that were near us said, well, that's a glory coming through. And I think everyone was taken by surprise by that.
I was a bit concerned on the first day with the rush and how that cloud came in. The strong wind started to blow. And I said, oh, shit, you know, that could go wrong. Okay, but yeah, you guys pulled it off.
I took off. I wanted to get the camera in the air right away. And as soon as I got in the air, I realized that I was pitched way too far forward, so I had to land immediately.
Pull the damn light. Too far forward.
Fortunately, the ground crew was really fast. Like a pit stop at the Indy 500, they had me switched out, and I was back in the air in a couple of minutes. And then we started head towards the cloud. And it's kind of like when you're heading towards that cloud, you're like, this is a really dumb thing to be doing.
I think for me, I was more nervous as the three of you were approaching the cloud, I think, because that was the unknown.
We got over there, and sure enough, just like they say in all those websites and all the stuff that's written about the glory, yep, the air's going up on the front. And that makes you think, okay, well, if that's true, then probably the other thing that they're saying is true, and that is that the air on the back is going down. So I want to make sure I stay on the front. I kind of saw it as soaring a ridge, a low ridge and a lot of wind. Stay out front. The higher you go, the further forward you need to be, and don't go over the back, because there's just no going over the back. It's just not a good idea, unless you're really high.
When you're on it, it's just... so much sensory overload, I suppose you could say. It was just incredible. We had to concentrate on where we were and what we were doing and each other. And you know, one simple mistake just led me into a cloud that was forming at the front. Just when I was getting up towards the cloud, I just went to test my speed bar, and it must have had the one of my releases hooked. So here I was flying towards this big cloud, wishing I had a speed bar. So I'm trying to connect it up as I'm flying, and not watching where I'm going. So by the time I got my speed bar connected up, I had done a right-hand turn into a cloud that had just started to form. And when I came through the cloud, there was a small airplane within a reasonably close distance.
as a kind of a checks and balances. We were all making sure that everybody was staying in front of this cloud, and no one hesitated to suggest that we needed to move out. We were all in it together. There was definitely some trust there as well, and there had to be for me in particular, because I had to focus on getting the shot. And whenever I did that, my mind was off where I was on that cloud. And as Matt found out, it only takes a few seconds to be in the wrong place, and you're in that cloud.
I think once you were on it and flying with it, I was definitely a lot more relaxed. At that point, we knew it was doable. I think the next worry from there was getting you down on the ground again.
We get down to about 500 feet, or more like maybe 300 feet, actually. And it's rough. And I said to Chris, you know, it's kind of rough, isn't it? And he goes, oh no, it's typical Australian weather here. Just sit back, relax, and enjoy it. So I did for about 10 seconds. And then I said, you know, I'm really getting banged around here pretty good. And he said, well, you know.
Just make sure you fly off the trimmers all the way out, filling up all out for this bit of rough air.
Probably got a lot of shots of my glider, looking up at my glider just to make sure it was still open. Because I'd never got knocked around that hard before. Sure enough, it stayed open. Really, was really, really impressed with that glider. But eventually, I guess due to my whining, everybody decided that they were sick of listening to me and they'd land in the middle of nowhere and wait to get picked up. But little did they know that once we landed, I'd be whining about the fact that it was taking the team forever to find us.
Once you got on the ground, I think all of us a bit relieved. It took us 4.5 hours to find you, but we got there in the end.
Chris, or any BFG pilots, copy Ben.
The boys have just landed not long ago. We couldn't quite get them on the two-way radio because they went out of range. Fortunately, Chris, we're able to raise Chris on the cell phone, and now we're on our way. What do you got there, Ben? You've got the...
We've got about another 16, 17 k to go, so the guys managed to cover off about 50 k on the cloud, managed to backtrack a bit, and they've landed about 20 k short of the airport.
We've got, as we're heading west here, away from the airport, I'm looking over here in the northern sky and I can see a couple of glider pilots, sailplanes coming back from riding the cloud. So now we just got to find them, and then we can have a debrief over a cold ale or two.
A couple of cold beers at 8:30 in the morning, but
8:30.
We've only slept 4 hours in the last 3 days, so it's all one big blur. But I tell you, that was sensational.
Righto, boys, hold tight. Here we come.
It could have been beyond paragliders, and people you had talked about said it's beyond a soft wing.
Why?
Because of the speed of it. You know, you hear about the wind blowing at 90 kilometres an hour and it travelling across the ground, and gusts of, you know, 100 k's an hour, and it's just definitely not paraglidable. But we proved them wrong.
I think a lot of the pilots there knew that no one had ever done this before. I reckon some of them were expecting us to fail and fail in a big way, and it was just magic to prove them wrong and prove that it could be done. And you know, I think they're going to see a lot more paramotor pilots up there over the years to come.
Now that we've done it, it makes it easier for other people to do it because they can share from our experience.
I'd just like to thank Jake at the Burketown Caravan Park. His weather briefs and his forecasts are incredible. He's a great fella, and I think he was a part of the team in the end.
But you enjoyed yourself.
I did. I had a great time. Thank you so much.
How many are you going to get for us now?
You're going to have to double the size of this place.
Well, why don't you buy the park off me?
People describe the cloud from the ground and how awesome and how big and powerful, and it is. But from a really light aircraft like ours, from the air, it's just totally different. You know, the word awesome is overused, but this is what it is. It's absolutely awesome. It's you'd really need to experience it to appreciate it.
I'm going back.
Yeah, it was an adventure out of this world.
The first paramotors, the first paragliders to fly the Morning Glory. That was a real honor and just an amazing amount of luck and preparation that collided to make that happen. And I'm very, very grateful to you guys for having me along.
Yeah, cheers, mate.